Hi, Lindsay.
Hey, Liz.
You run our equity capital markets business for consumer retail companies. What have you seen as the biggest impact on those industries in the last few months?
So one of the more surprising things we've seen across the last few months is where consumers have actually shifted their spending. And while we might have expected things like cruise lines or hotels or restaurants to feel the impact of diminished spending, you may not have expected to see a significant reduction in things like razor blades, deodorant, cosmetics, fragrances. So America has really experienced a pretty significant change in grooming habits over the last few months. And some of these categories have been running down 10, 20, 30% or so. So pretty significant. I think also what's been interesting is where we've seen consumers shift their money to that may not have been expected. So athletic apparel, you know, people buying more workout clothes, home decor and home renovation, those categories have been very, very strong. RVs and campers. And some of those categories are especially surprising in light of the recession and the overall economic dynamics. So the fact that we're seeing strength there is actually, you know, a really interesting spotlight on culturally where America is today in the midst of a shutdown versus what you might expect during your run-of-the-mill type recession.
And to what extent do you think these trends are here to stay?
I think one of the kind of remarkable coincidences about the pandemic is that the ways that it impacted consumer spending in some ways is the acceleration of trends we've been seeing all along. So let's talk about shopping online, right? Many companies, whether it's retailers or restaurants with digital ordering, have been pushing along this curve, you know, some of them slowly and methodically, but this, you know, stay at home and the shutdowns accelerated that. So you really got broad adoption in areas like grocery, which had been tougher corners of the market to crack. Or think about casualization of attire, right? You know, dress shoes and dress apparel, you know, Goldman Sachs, we started, you know, casual dress code, which was a big departure from historically what the firm had done. Now we dress casually every day. And so that those kind of trends of digital casualization, using social media as a primary form of entertainment, many of them were already in the works. And what we've seen with COVID is just a sort of acceleration of those trends. And I think it'll be interesting to see how kind of pushing further along that curve quickly, what that means for how consumers will spend when we're out of lockdown. Will we go back to stores the same way? Will we go back to eating in restaurants? A lot of that's unclear, but the consensus is that the consumer has been fundamentally changed.
Well, given the immediate focus on liquidity at the beginning of the economic shutdown, what is the role of the equity issuance market been for consumer and retail companies?
So one really important dynamic to point out is that equity markets and equity investors and the liquidity they provided in the worst of this crisis were absolutely essential to the sustained functioning of the economy. And it was really important, you know, as somebody who works in the capital markets or as we talk to our clients, you know, as companies that think about, should I be public, should I not be public? One of the arguments for being public is that, you know, overall access to public markets provides you a lower cost of capital on a day-to-day basis. But in this instance, not only is it just the argument of a lower cost of capital day to day, but in an extreme stress scenario, having access to public investors, public equity investors, was make or break for so many different companies. And those that were able to flex their access to public markets were able to do so and get, you know, essential liquidity to keep their operations running. May and June were the two biggest months in history for equity issuance. And that's true broadly across the market. It's certainly true in consumer. And as we saw, you know, consumer spending and business spending really seize up in February and into March and beyond, companies in real need of liquidity to pay their employees, to pay the rent, to keep their businesses functioning, turned to the equity markets to get vital liquidity to keep them in operations. And that, you know, the equity markets provided liquidity that debt markets couldn't absorb, or where it just wasn't responsible for these companies to load themselves, their balance sheets up with significant amount of debt. And I think moreover, while we saw a number of important private equity transactions the public markets were a much, much, much bigger supplier of vital liquidity, which, you know, helped businesses continue to run.
So what are the biggest drivers of this activity?
I characterize the activity into four different buckets. The first were true rescue financings, and these were companies that didn't have a lot of other options, that were in critical need of liquidity, and whether it was through issuing stock or issuing stock and some other combination of securities, they were able to get critical funds to keep their businesses operating. Those were a lot more common sort of early on. If we're talking about late March, early April, we saw a lot more of those rescue type financings. We've also seen the next bucket I would characterize as businesses going on offense. So raising capital, not because they were in dire need, but because they believed that having extra liquidity would help cement their competitive advantage versus others who didn't have as much liquidity, keep them from having to upend their talent organizations, allow them to invest in their brands, allow them to forge strong relationships with their factories, their landlords, et cetera. And so that was an important move that we saw. The third bucket was monetizations. So large shareholders of big public companies who look to sell stock in the public market as a way to get liquidity for portfolio realignment. They had other ways they wanted to put that money to work. That was another significant driver of activity. And then most recently, we've seen IPO markets pick up and a number of landmark transactions, whether it's Warner Music or Albertsons or JD Peet's. We've had a bunch of great IPOs come to market because investor risk appetite has been strong. And overall, you know, we've been able to absorb a significant amount of that new supply across those buckets, and the market really has not missed a beat.
And do you think the return of the IPO market is here to stay?
The IPO markets are driven by two things. Is there risk appetite among public market investors? Yes, there is. And number two, will public investors pay a sufficient value relative to private investors or relative to other alternatives? And yes, they are. So we're optimistic that the IPO market, and based on our backlog, will be robust through the end of this year into 2021 and hopefully beyond.
So finally, Lindsay, as we enter the third quarter, in what ways are consumer retail companies now turning to the equity capital markets?
Right now, the stock market is strong and risk appetite from investors for new issues is very, very good. And there's a lot of different ways we see issuers looking to take advantage of that healthy risk appetite. First of all, as I mentioned, we're going to see some important IPOs coming to market in the third quarter and certainly into the back half of the year. Second, we expect to see some issuers who are already public and whose stocks have traded well to take advantage of their stock values today and issue incremental equity to get new liquidity, especially in the face of, you know, uncertain trading around the election, uncertain business dynamics around, you know, what will case rates do? Will certain economies shut back down? So they're going to be opportunistic and raise capital today ahead of uncertainty tomorrow. Third, we expect to see more shareholders of already public companies look to monetize to find ways to get liquidity and redeploy that capital in different means. We're going to see SPACs, and we're going to see pre-IPO private placement. So really across the board in our business, we expect a really healthy calendar into the third quarter and really beyond.
Thanks, Lindsay.
Thank you.